This video was brought to you by supporters on Patreon. This is an x-ray of a human hand. It should look pretty familiar. Some phalanges, 5 metacarpals, and exactly 8 carpal bones, or wrist bones. But why 8? Why not 5, or 10, or even just 1 bone? After all, these few bones make the main joint with our radius to make our wrist, so why not just fuse everything together? My background is in kinesiology, so I know how the modern wrist moves, not how we got the modern wrist. On the other hand, evolutionary biologists and anthropologists have a good idea of how wrists evolved, since they were so important to how our ancestors used tools, and thus, how we survived as a species. Going into this video, I thought that I could read a handful of papers and get the gist of this topic and make a quick video. Oh, how wrong I was. It might not seem like it at first glance, but our carpals are different from our ape cousins. Like, this is the human pisiform bone, and this is the gorilla pisiform. A little different, right? As I continued researching, I found that each of these 8 bones evolved independently from one another, and each has their own story. So, grab the peanut butter-filled pretzels. This is gonna be a long video. Skeletons started in the oceans around 500 million years ago. At first, it was a couple bony fishes, then came tetrapods, or animals with 4 limbs. We think that the first version of a tetrapod limb happened around 370 million years ago, and because it was so fresh and so clean, these first limbs didn't have a wrist, or a hoof, or a paw yet for that matter. The carpal bones themselves didn't start evolving until tetrapods got digits, or what we would call fingers and toes. Those first digits were probably evolved radial bones like ray-finned fish have today. Tetrapods kept evolving in the ocean until they came on land, which led to some big changes in their body plan. Like, early aquatic tetrapods propelled themselves with their front limbs, while tetrapods on land generate force with their hind limbs, which is why butt muscles and pelvises became such a big deal. As one of the papers I read put it, tetrapods had to evolve from front wheel drive to rear wheel drive, which is just an adorable metaphor, you know? But that's why we can recognize a lot of the same bones in horses, chinchillas, or penguins, is because they all came from this early tetrapod ancestor. And all modern tetrapods have something between the digits and the distal limb. From there, the story of the wrist goes on some serious tangents and side quests, with early tetrapods evolving 6, 7, or 8 fingers. But for the most part, after this body plan happened, the definition of wrist bones would be solid. They were some kind of short bone interface between the long bones of the forearm and fingers, with a few modern exceptions, namely crocodilians and frogs and toads. Their proximal row of carpal bones are long bones, not short bones. And at this point in evolution, we're starting to work with the traditional tetrapod skeletal plan, and we can start following homologs of specific anatomy. These are anatomical features that started with a common ancestor, but got reshaped over evolution. Just like how we can follow the evolution of, like, fish across time, we can also follow the evolution of specific bones. Homologs can be developmental patterns and genetic similarities too, but comparative anatomists base their study on anatomical homologs, which is what a lot of the studies for my research used. For instance, we can clearly see the radius and ulna bones as homologs in all kinds of animals, but sometimes we need to use multiple clues to show that one bone, or muscle, or whatever, is homologous to some other animal's anatomy. For example, us humans have muscles called interossei muscles between our fingers, while other primates have 2 muscles around that area. So, which muscle is the interossei muscle a homolog to? We don't have a solid answer. Maybe it's a homolog to one, but not the other, or maybe sometime in evolution they fused into one muscle for our hands. And while I could spend hours going down rabbit holes of mammal wrist homologs, no, literally, this is a rabbit wrist, scientists are interested in the homologs of primates. If you saw my video about human spine evolution, then you'll remember that a huge factor in anatomy is locomotion, or how an animal moves. And in general, we can split primates into 4 locomotion groups. Quadrupeds, which includes knuckle walkers like gorillas, tree swingers like gibbons, leapers like tarsiers, and bipeds, which are mostly humans, but other primates can temporarily walk on 2 legs too. Since locomotion style is such a big deal in anatomy, we'd expect knuckle walkers to have similar wrists to knuckle walkers, and tree climbers to have similar wrists to tree climbers. But it's not always that simple. Some animals happen to evolve the same characteristic despite having different movement styles. So in 2013, research published in BMC Evolutionary Biology described this big comparative morphology study, which brought in Homo sapiens, apes, Old World monkeys, New World monkeys, and a few fossilized hominins, all of which have different locomotion styles. Some walk on 2 legs, some grab onto branches, some walk on their knuckles, and some, as the paper put it, use ricochetal brachiation, which is the science word for swinging. They could have literally said monkey bars, and they didn't. And it turned out that some of our primate family members evolved a bunch of anatomy in parallel with each other. The study also pointed out that certain pieces of anatomy, including different carpal bones, evolve faster or slower than other pieces, and they evolve independently of each other. Yes, they all make up the same joint and kind of act as a module, but evolution of each bone is different. This is mosaicism. You can have anatomy change completely separately from other anatomy. Some bones were heavily influenced by locomotion, in particular the capitate, triquetrum, and scaphoid. So you would expect those three bones to look different when you compare tree swingers to knuckle walkers to full-time bipeds like us, because our locomotion styles are so different. But others, like the lunate and hamate, were influenced more by that animal's clade than how they moved. So for those bones, your locomotion style was less important. It was your place in the family tree that determined what those bones looked like. Like gibbons. These are the classic comparison monkeys for a tree-swinging primate, so we'd expect their hands to be built for it. And their hamate bones are much longer and have a little hook called a hamulus, which is an advantage for swinging through trees. Compare that to spider monkeys, which are still tree swingers, but they don't have the cool hamate hook. Other studies have shown that these two species have pretty similar shoulders and elbows, but their wrists are the big morphological difference. What about some of these other bones? Well, it's complicated. Like, orangutans and gibbons have really similar triquetrum and capitate bones, even though they don't move around the same way. Gibbons are tree swingers, while orangutans kind of scramble. But these styles of locomotion favor wrist mobility over wrist stability, so their similar carpal bones match up from that perspective. On the flip side, knuckle walkers favor a strong, stable wrist, so they're the opposite. Now, if we wanted to summarize things up until this point, we can explain some of the evolutionary journey this way. Knuckle walking wrists prioritize stability, while tree dwelling wrists prioritize mobility, which brings us to humans. Almost. Homo sapiens share a recent common ancestor with chimps and bonobos. If we want to tell the story of our wrists, we need to ask how this ancestor moved around. Were they knuckle walkers, tree climbers? What was their deal? According to the most recent review that I could find, the best hypothesis that experts have is that we likely evolved from knuckle walkers, but there's conflicting evidence. Hominoids, or apes, are special. Of all the primate clades, there's a ton of carpal bone variation among apes, especially the hamate, triquetrum, lunate, and capitate. This suggests that the apes are under increased selective pressure compared to other species, at least when it comes to wrists. For example, our Homo sapien triquetrum looks more like gorillas and chimps than Neanderthals, which is weird, since our locomotion style and tool usage is closer to Neanderthals than gorillas. According to that BMC paper I mentioned earlier, this suggests that we evolved similar triquetrum bones at the same time as chimps and gorillas. Maybe we evolved these beefy triquetrum because tool use put extra stress on that side of our wrists, like how gorillas put weight on their knuckles, but we haven't been able to test that. And then there's the scaphoid, which is the research topic that ultimately nosedived my descent into madness for this script. And it's because of this thing, the os carpi centrali, a free-floating bone near the intersection of the trapezoid, scaphoid, and capitate bones. Humans and gorillas are usually born with this bone fused to their scaphoid. Sometimes it fused to their trapezoid or capitate, but almost always the scaphoid. The most popular thought is that when the os centrali is fused to the scaphoid, it makes the wrist more rigid for knuckle walking, and for modern humans, it might contribute to wrist stability too. The pisiform bone is a little different. This little dude hangs on the ulnar side of the wrist. Apes have longer pisiform, which gives them some extra torque when swinging or knuckle walking. Ours is short and stubby, while gorillas and chimps have growth plates in theirs. So our pisiform is smaller than all of our evolutionary cousins, but our calcaneus is wider and thicker than other apes. Now, why am I mentioning a bone in the foot all of a sudden? Well, the pisiform and calcaneus are paralogs of each other, two different structures that evolved in parallel. Basically, the calcaneus is the foot version of the pisiform, and the pisiform is the hand version of the calcaneus. A paper published in Evo Devo in 2019 described how they're the only carpal and tarsal that have two ossification centers and a growth plate. If you've never heard of Evo Devo or evolutionary developmental biology before, it's basically when scientists learn things about evolution by studying development. So if we look at how these bones develop in utero, the pisiform is the hand version of the heel bone, and so on. That tells us that as we evolved bipedalism, the pisiform kind of shrank, and lost a growth plate over time, while the calcaneus got bigger and kept its ossification center and growth plate. Now, around the time that our ancestors got out of the trees and started walking on two legs is when we start seeing a record of this big new heel bone, but not the new pisiform yet. That gives us the idea that the calcaneus evolved in relation to walking upright, while the pisiform was an adaptation to tool use. And tool use wouldn't just shape the pisiform, it was such a big deal that it would reshape the rest of the hand. Now, I had one lingering question while researching all of this. Is tool use that powerful of a driver of evolution? Like, does it impact survival or reproduction so much that evolution will select risks that favor complex tool usage? There are two hypotheses that go together for this that say humans can move their hands and grip tools in totally unique ways, and if that's true, we'll have evolved unique carpal anatomy as well. Basically, it's this loop of form influencing function, influencing form, and so on. And to that end, humans do have pieces of unique anatomy that let us do unique things with our hands, like hand proportion and robust thumbs. We have short fingers relative to our thumbs, especially when you compare them to chimps and gorillas. And those thumbs are surrounded by muscles, including a unique mechanical advantage for the opponent's pollicis muscle, the muscle that lets us do opposition of the thumb. We have some differently shaped carpal bones compared to other apes, like we have larger trapezium bones to accommodate all the compressive force from squeezing stuff. Plus, the carpo-metacarpal joints are oriented in a way that allows humans to cup their hands, making it possible to do the baseball grip. Our digits have big bumps or tuberosities on the far end of our relatively flat fingers. And finally, we have such strange wrist mobility. We can do all kinds of weird combined double axis movements. And that shows up in the things that we can do with our hands that other primates can't. Like chimps straight up can't do certain precision grips, this style of grip. While baboons and capuchins can precision grip, but not very forcefully. This is why capuchins pound open nuts with rocks. It's adorable. So far, macaques are the closest at having a strong and precise grip, but scientists are figuring out how that became a thing. Now, humans have all kinds of unique gripping styles. Like, key grip lets us hold a flake and use it to cut things, the baseball grip lets us shape tools precisely, and the hammer grip lets us use tools to smash or hammer thing. Then there's the dart thrower's motion, which is unique to humans, so according to this hypothesis, our wrists evolved in a way that allowed that motion. How that became the wrist of modern-day humans is still a mystery, but a report from 2010 tried. And they gave it this amazing title, The Advantage of Throwing the First Stone. But there are still a ton of unanswered questions in this story. We know what we can do, but we want to figure out what our ancestors could do with their hands, because we still don't know. My sources go back decades, and so many of them end with, we'd still love to know how our last common ancestor with chimps used their hands. And speaking of a smooth transition to the Patreon plug, this script took over 40 hours to research and write. I always post an annotated version of my script a few days early for patrons, and if you want early access to scripts and videos, and want to support your local neighborhood anatomy teacher in the process, head over to Patreon. You can also check out some of my other videos here, and if you haven't, please subscribe and hit the bell icon so you get notified when I post a new video. I appreciate all of you who have watched this far. Have fun, be good, thanks for watching.